Our subject of the morning is the proper posture of prayer. In keeping with the emphasis on prayer for this year, we are bringing another message on this vital theme. We've spoken on this subject more than any other during the past year. We want to bring the impact of the Word of God on this all-important and necessary exercise with the full confidence that some folk will have their prayer life deepened and refreshed. Now this morning we are confining ourselves to the posture of prayer. And I know immediately that some folk are saying you don't mean that the posture in prayer has any significance whatsoever. May I say to you that we are talking this morning about the position of the body while praying. And I have often wondered why the church in the past has not been divided on this subject. This issue is an issue that could have divided the church, and everything else has divided it. The mode of baptism has certainly divided the church. And believe me, the church is divided on that theme today. There are those that believe that immersion is the correct mode. There are those who believe that sprinkling is the correct mode. And then there are a few today that believe that pouring is the correct mode. That means to get a pitcher of water and douse it on the head. There are a group of those folk in Georgia, by the way. Then there are those that believe that you should be immersed, but not just one time. You should be immersed three times. Then there are those that believe that you ought not to be only immersed three times, but the way you do it's important. There are those that believe you ought to go down head first. There are others believe that you ought to go backwards. There are some that believe that two times is the correct one. And then there are those today, and they are in the South, that believe that only running water is the right kind of water. And if it's not running water, you haven't really been baptized. You can see that baptism has certainly divided the church. It's a wonder that the posture of prayer didn't divide the church. It's a wonder that we don't have a group today known as the Standers. They believe in standing up when you pray. Then it's a wonder that we don't have a group of the kneelers who believe that you should kneel down when you pray. Then there ought to be a group of the sitters. They believe that you should sit when you pray. Then another group that believe you ought to lie down. They are the liars. That would really be a large group. I didn't realize that anyone else had dwelt on this, and as I was coming down this morning to the pulpit, someone handed me this poem. It's the prayer of Cyrus Brown. The proper way for a man to pray, said Deacon Lemuel Keyes, and the only proper attitude is down upon his knees. No, I should say the way to pray, said Reverend Dr. Wise, is standing straight with outstretched arms and wrapped in upturned eyes. Oh, no, 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 said Elder Slow. Such posture is too proud. A man should pray with eyes fast closed and head contritely bowed. It seems to me his hands should be austerely clasped in front, with both thumbs pointing toward the ground, said Reverend Dr. Blunt. Last year I fell in Hodkin's well, head first, said Cyrus Brown, with both my heels a-sticking up, my head a-pinting down. The prayingest prayer I ever prayed was a-standing on my head. Is the mode of prayer, the posture of prayer, essential? May I say categorically and dogmatically, no. It's not essential, but it's important. The posture of your body at the time of prayer has nothing to do with it, the effectiveness of the prayer. God hears and answers prayer regardless of the posture of the body. And it was Victor Hugo who said that the soul is on its knees many times regardless of the position of the body. The answer and the power of prayer are not determined by the posture. The mode does not affect God, and it won't change God one whit. But may I say to you this morning that the posture has an effect upon the believer, and it has an effect upon others. For the posture reveals the attitude of the life and of the soul. Now somebody says, but Scripture suggests several postures, does it not? Yes, it does. You'll find that standing in prayer is a scriptural mode. I think that you'll find that that was the mode used more often in the Old Testament than any other. And the New Testament opens with a prayer meeting with Zacharias standing at the altar of prayer. That's where God broke in. But it's also interesting to note that there has been something said by our Lord concerning standing in prayer. And will you listen to this now very carefully? When thou prayest, our Lord is speaking, when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Our Lord said that the Pharisees were like hypocrites, that they liked to be seen. And therefore they stood praying. And you know, our Lord didn't let it go at that. He gave a parable about two men praying, and he said the Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself. So that our Lord suggests at least that standing in prayer has the element of ministering to the pride of heart. It can lead to nothing in the world but a proud spirit. Now somebody says, what is the correct posture in prayer? May I suggest to you this morning that kneeling according to the Word of God is the correct posture of prayer. I want this morning to give you four instances of men who knelt in prayer and the great lesson that it teaches. Two of these are from the Old Testament and two of these are from the New Testament. I want us to look at Solomon as he knelt in prayer at the dedication of the temple. I want us to look at Daniel as he knelt in prayer toward Jerusalem with a decree out that no man was to make any petition to anyone other than the king. And then I want us to see the prayer of our Lord Jesus Christ in the Garden of Gethsemane when he knelt. And then to see the prayer of Paul together with the Ephesian elders down upon the seashore. Will you look at these with me? In the prayer of Solomon, we see creature humility. In the prayer of Daniel, we see courage. In the prayer of the Lord Jesus Christ, we see commitment. And in Paul and the Ephesian elders, we see communication. Will you look at these for just a moment? First, let's take a look at the prayer of Solomon. I'm turning to 1 Chronicles, the 6th chapter, the 13th verse, and I'd like to read here very carefully. For Solomon had made a brazen scaffold of 5 cubits long, 5 cubits broad, and 3 cubits high. had set it in the midst of the court, and upon it he stood and kneeled down upon his knees before all the congregation of Israel and spread forth his hands toward heaven. Now, in the prayer of Solomon, you see creature humility. Solomon was the king, and men bowed to him. There was no man on top side of this earth that he bowed to, not a one. God had taken Solomon's father, David, from a place of humility and had elevated him to a very high position. In fact, God reminded him of that through Nathan the prophet. He had said to him, "Now therefore, so shalt thou say unto my servant David, thus saith the Lord of hosts, I took thee from the sheepcote, from following after the sheep, to be ruler over my people Israel." God said to David, "I reached down when you were just an humble shepherd boy, and I took you up from the very bottom, and I've elevated you, and I made you king." And it actually didn't seem likely that Solomon would be the one to follow David. Very unlikely, because of the fact that actually Solomon was not the favorite of David at all. But God chose him. And when Solomon was elevated above all the sons of David, David had said this to him, "I go the way of all the earth. Be thou strong, therefore, and show thyself a man. Keep the charge of the Lord thy God, to walk in his ways, to keep his statutes and his commandments and his judgments and his testimonies, as it is written in the law of Moses, that thou mayest prosper in all that thou doest and whithersoever thou turnest thyself." Now David, that on his deathbed, called Solomon in. It's obvious he wasn't his choice. He said, "Son, you really do not know what a rugged life is. I was a shepherd boy. God took me. And then he schooled me out yonder in the dens and caves of the earth. I've been a man of war. I'm a rough man. But you, I remember when you were born, and your mother, I loved your mother. And we brought you up in the palace. I never saw you very often, but every time I saw you, you were a little sissy. You had on soft raiment. You look like little Lord Fauntleroy. And I want you to know, Solomon, you do not know what life really is. You don't know how to meet it and face it. But my charge to you is, I want you to be a man." And now this man, Solomon, has been elevated to the highest position. He's built a temple. That temple, it's estimated today, costs over $5 million. And there was not a plaque on it dedicated to Solomon. Thank God for that. We call it today Solomon's Temple. It wasn't Solomon's Temple. The only temple Solomon ever had was on the side of his head. He did not have a temple built down here. It wasn't his. It was God's temple. You read his prayer. And if you're going to dedicate it to any man, dedicate it to David. It's David's temple, not Solomon's. But Solomon is the king, king of peace. And they come to the time of dedication, and there stands that man on a brazen platform that's put above all the people. And any direction that Solomon looked, he looked down. And if you want to see Solomon in all of his glory, look at him at the dedication. He never was so high. From then on, he went down in any direction he went. But now he's elevated to the pinnacle. And I see this man, and there is now one lesson that he did get from his father. And I see him going down on his knees before Almighty God. Glory has filled that house as it had filled the tabernacle. And he gets down on his knees before God. That is the proper posture of the creature. You see, man is a creature on this earth. And believe me, he's small. Man is a midget in this universe. They have now been able to look out into space farther than they ever have before. Not with Palomar. And I understand that Dr. Hale has made the statement that'll probably be the last reflecting telescope ever built. They'll never make one larger. You know why? Because today they have out here in Owens Valley, they have radio telescopes like great bows. And they have already been able to detect, not yet translate into picture, but they will. There are out yonder galactic systems that have went out of business billions of years ago, and they're still sending back a message. Or else they're moving so fast now from this earth, they're moving faster than light, and they can't get anything through. When you begin to look at man today, when I consider thy heavens, the work of thy fingers, what is man that thou art mindful of him? Did you know there's not a man on top side of this earth today that knows enough to speak anything officially on any subject right now? He can't speak on the age of the earth. He can't speak on the origin of it. Doesn't know enough. All that the new knowledge has brought is that man is extremely small and he's ignorant. What is the proper position of this little creature that someone said is just a skin disease on the epidermis of a little planet? His proper position is down on his knees before his Creator. And Solomon, in all of his glory, with the multitudes bowing to him, he kneels before his God. And that's where we belong. That's where man belongs today. Down on his knees before Almighty God. Let me move on. Let's come to Daniel. And I read here in the 10th verse of the 6th chapter of Daniel. Now when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went into his house, and his windows being open in his chamber toward Jerusalem, he kneeled upon his knees 3 times a day, and prayed and gave thanks before his God as he did aforetime. Darius ruled under Cyrus, and he was an enlightened ruler. He knew the value of a man like Daniel, and he had lifted Daniel to a position, actually, in which he really controlled the kingdom and all outside affairs. He would correspond today to the Vice President and the Secretary of State rolled into one office. And because this man, a Jew, had been brought to such a high pinnacle of elevation, he'd enjoyed such a position under Babylon, under Nebuchadnezzar, but now under a new kingdom, he finds himself back again in high position. The enemies were jealous of him. They hated him. And they sought to try to trap him. The greatest compliment concerning Daniel is it comes from his enemies. His enemies said that we can't find anything wrong with this man. This man is in his office is faithful to God. He's faithful to the king. You won't find anything wrong with his books, and you'll find that he's at the office every morning, and he doesn't leave till quitting time, and he's loyal to the king. We'll not find anything wrong with this man. The only place we can get at him is concerning his religion. And he's got some very funny ideas. This man, three times a day, goes into his chamber, his windows open toward Jerusalem, and he prays three times a day. I'll not turn to it, but if you turn to Solomon's prayer of dedication, which we did not follow this morning, you'll find that in that prayer, Solomon said, when thy people sin and are carried away into captivity, if in the place of their captivity they pray toward Jerusalem three times a day, thou wilt hear in heaven. This man Daniel is following God's instructions. And so he's praying toward Jerusalem three times a day. So they said, we'll get at him. And this crowd came together. They're a clever crowd. You can be sure of that. This crowd's always clever. And they said, we want to get at him. We want to hurt him. And we can't hurt him in any place except his religion. Now let's get the king, because the king likes him. Go way out on a tangent and get the king to make a rule that nobody is to worship anybody except the king. Only of the king are you to ask a petition. Now that, of course, appealed to Darius as it would to any ruler, especially those that were eaten up with egotism, and many of them were. It's nice to be flattered and have nobody coming to anybody but you. And Darius fell for it. He didn't realize what was the implications were. And so these men, they were ready. Now Daniel did something we need to know. Daniel went into his room. Now he didn't do anything that was foolhardy. He didn't fling the window open and pray. Some people would say that that would be faith to do that. He didn't do that. Nor did this man do something cowardly. He didn't close the window. The window was already open. That was his custom. And he did not do anything foolhardy. That's not faith. And he didn't do anything cowardly, for that's not faith. And this man went in, and he didn't let the decree affect him one whit. I hear some people say today, if you just take everything to God in prayer, that he'll get you out of all your trouble. It'll put you on easy street, take all the thorns off all the roses, and all the stones out of your pathway. I do not know about that, but I do know this. Daniel prayed himself right into a lion's den. That's the way he got in the lion's den. He prayed himself into it. But I think we ought to add, he prayed himself out of it also. He went into the lion's den because he was a man of prayer. And he was delivered out of the lion's den because he was a man of prayer. The courage of Daniel is evidenced by the fact that he had kneeled down before God at a time like that. Let me move on. I come to the New Testament. And I come to the Lord Jesus Christ in the Garden of Gethsemane. And will you listen to the record that Dr. Luke gives? In Luke 22:41, he was withdrawn from them about a stone's cast and kneeled down and prayed. And in that, we have commitment. Commitment to God. For it's in these prayers that he uttered in the Garden of Gethsemane that he said finally, not my will, but thine be done. Commitment to God. And not only did he kneel down, Matthew goes just a little farther, and Matthew tells us, and he went a little farther and fell on his face and prayed. That he not only knelt down, but he actually got down on his face before God. May I say to you, he set a pattern that was followed by the first martyr in the church. For the first martyr in the church, it said of him, of Stephen, in Acts 7:60, he kneeled down and cried with a loud voice, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. I believe they knocked him to his knees. That's true, but that's the position that this man Stephen got in. He was following our Lord. It was commitment, absolute commitment to God. And I'll not take time this morning to turn to some of these others in the Old Testament where you see men kneeling before God. It was, if you please, Moses and Aaron at the time of the rebellion of Korah. And God says, let me alone, I'll destroy this people. And we're told that Aaron and Moses went down on their knees before God and said, you'll not destroy an entire people because of the sin of just a few. God heard and answered their prayer. And then we find Joshua, General Joshua, the man who succeeded Moses. I believe that this man Joshua never dreamed he would follow Moses. He did not believe that he was capable. He is the great encouragement to many of us. Joshua reveals what God can do with an average man. For this man Joshua was only an average man. But when he found himself in the position of Moses, of running the show, he became General Joshua. And you find General Joshua taken over at the beginning. When they crossed the Jordan River, God had encouraged him in his heart, and he was, I think, a little proud, for he got up the first morning and he looked down at the edge of the camp, and there was a man with a drawn sword. And General Joshua had given no command to anybody to draw a sword. And evidently, there's somebody in that camp doesn't know who's the boss. So General Joshua went striding down like a second lieutenant. And as nobody can stride like a second lieutenant, he went striding down. And he walks up to this man and he says to him, what's the big idea? You say, my Bible doesn't say that. No, our Bible says, art thou for us or for our adversaries? That's the same thing. Don't you know who's in command here? And then this one turned. He was the captain of the Lord of hosts. He was the pre-incarnate Christ. And Joshua saw him. And when Joshua saw him, he found out something that many of us need to find out, that GHQ is not down here in our little tent. It is up yonder. And General Joshua went down on his face and he says, what will my Lord have me to do? I have no problem now with this man leading the children of Israel around Jericho for 7 days. If you'd ever stopped him and said to him, General Joshua, don't you know this is absurd? He'd have said, yes, it sure is. Well, why are you doing it? He'd said, you just evidently do not know who's the general. I'm not the general. I take orders. I got orders from up yonder to go around the city. That's all I know. And it's not for me to inquire, it's for me to obey. And I'm obeying. Obedience. My friend today, if there ever was a time when God's people needed to get out on their knees and make a commitment of their life to God, this is the day. How many of us still have GHQ under our own little shirt? We make our own decisions. We are running the show the way we want it run. And we're not taking orders from up yonder. We need to go down on our knees before it. Commitment. Even the Lord Jesus Christ in the Garden of Gethsemane, and I'm not entering into the reasons, but I do know this. He said, let the cup pass. And then he said, not my will, but thine be done. Commitment to God. I come to the last. Paul and the Ephesian elders, communication to others. Will you notice this tremendous thing that is said here in the 20th chapter of the book of Acts, the 36th verse? When he had thus spoken, he kneeled down and prayed with them all. Paul had founded the church in Ephesus. Those of you who attend on Thursday night know that we believe, and I think with some support, that this church was the finest church of all. Paul did his outstanding work in Ephesus. He was strangely drawn to the people in Ephesus. So when he's on the way with the offering to Jerusalem, knowing that when he went up there he'd be arrested and never again would he see their faces, he called for the elders of the church in Ephesus to come down. It's one of the most tender meetings that you'll ever see. Paul says, I know that after my decease, ravenous wolves are going to come in among you. I want to give to you my report that while I was among you, I did preach the word. I did it with weeping. Now I'm leaving you. Now he says, let's have prayer. And down on the seashore, the elders and Paul knelt in prayer. Not to show, it was not like the Pharisees that our Lord says, do not be like the Pharisees who love to be seen a man when they pray. These men were not trying to be seen a man, but they sure did communicate something there that day. I have a notion that many of the sailors that were down there ready to go on a voyage with fear and trembling, wondering what the voyage would hold, they looked at those men and said, I wonder if they really are praying to the living and true God. I have a notion that many of the loved ones of the men leaving, they drew near wistfully to hear what they were praying about. I have a notion that a great many that had come down for a holiday to the beach, cavorting on the sand, they paused for a moment and looked at these men kneeling there in prayer. I heard of several Christian couples at a resort, observed by a man who is himself a Christian and watched them. He said, believe me, even when they ate their hamburgers, they didn't return thanks. He said, you couldn't tell on the Lord's Day who they really were. How many today are giving a testimony by your life to those about you? Christians today are afraid to be marked as a peculiar people. Oh, somebody might say something. I hope you won't misunderstand me in saying this. I went through Montgomery, Alabama the other morning, visited there for about 30 minutes. I have no sympathy with folk who break the law, whether it's north or south. But I must confess that kneeling down in prayer on the Capitol grounds impressed me. And I'll tell you how it impressed me. I said, how many Christians today would do that? How many will? I don't mean to make a spectacle of yourself and to be an oddball. He said that we are a peculiar people, not to act peculiar. Some act peculiar. You don't have to act peculiar. How many in a natural way, as I saw a businessman in Tacoma, Washington, several years ago in a cocktail party of the lumberman, take his glass, just turned it upside down, said, make mine ginger ale. And if you don't think, since he's an outstanding lumberman, if you don't think that had a testimony, I wish you could have seen some of these goggle-eyed that were already half drunk. I wish you could have seen them look at him. I sat in the lobby and watched it as they had ranged the corner of the hotel for it. Believe me, he had a testimony. What's your testimony today without being odd? You can witness by a posture in prayer. May I be personal just one more time? I came the other evening on the train from Atlanta up to Evansville, Indiana, over ground I hadn't been over for 25 years. We went through a little place called Tullahoma, Tennessee. I don't guess any of you ever heard of Tullahoma, Tennessee. But I used to go see a girl that lived there. And there's a conference grounds 3 miles from there. And the other night, I couldn't go to sleep. I stayed awake till we almost got to Evansville. Never did go to sleep. I put up the shade and I looked out and told them, believe me, it's still as country as it always was. They got no subdivisions going there. In that conference ground, oh, quite a few years ago now, I went as just a boy in my teens. I never shall forget. I was the problem child in that conference, so they said. I didn't think so, but they thought so. But they do not know the effect they had on this boy. I'd never seen anybody kneel in prayer. And in our cabin that night, the counselor got us around a bunch of boys. And the old knelt in prayer, I had never seen that. And that's impressed me to this day. Posture in prayer. I want to conclude now, but I want you to look at somebody that really got in a kneeling position. Old Elijah, and you might know he would outdo anybody else. Listen to him. In 1 Kings 18:42, so Ahab went up to eat and to drink. And Elijah went up to the top of Carmel, and he cast himself down upon the earth and put his face between his knees. You ought to try that. I tried it. It's the most awkward position to pray in. And I was interested in what Dr. Newell says. Dr. Newell says it's so completely uncomfortable that there is little danger of growing drowsy or absent-minded while you're engaged. I guarantee you'll stay awake if you try this posture of prayer. Oh, my friend today, regardless of the position of the body, we need to pray today. We need to pray. And regardless of the position of the body, our hearts and lives should be on their knees before him. In fact, we should be down on our faces before him. Salvation today is determined by this posture of the soul. The epistle to the Romans that presents justification by faith and says that no sinner can even wiggle a finger and contribute to his salvation, that it's all of God, that he does it all. That you're justified by faith, and that it's by God's mercy that we are saved, and not by even our willing or our running. But this epistle has a parenthesis around it, and the parenthesis is obedience. Will you listen to it? In Romans 1:5, by whom we've received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for his name. And in Romans 16:26 at the end of the epistle, but now is made manifest and by the scriptures of the prophets according to the commandment of the everlasting God made known to all nations for the obedience of faith. And the faith that saves, saving faith, is a faith that sees itself without anything and down on its knees before Almighty God receives everything from him. I close with this. The other night in Evansville at that outstanding mission there that's been doing such a conspicuous work for over a half a century on the Ohio River. There were testimonies given. I've never heard such impressive testimonies. A great big hulk of a man got up, an executive type, great deep voice. The man in charge turned to me. He said he was the outstanding union leader in Evansville, and Evansville is a great union town. This man got up and he said, 5 years ago, I was proud. I never ask any man for anything. I could do it myself. And then liquor got me. And he had that gravel voice. And he said, I thought any day I'd quit it when I wanted to, but I never seemed to want to until I became an alcoholic. And one day, in desperation, having heard of this place, I came in here. And he said, I found out that when I laid aside everything I had trusted, laid aside everything that I was, and got down on my knees before God, let Him do it all, that He could save me. And he said, you know, He did save me. My friend, I'm confident that's the way you have to come to Him. If you are going to bring anything at all, even one little red cent, He doesn't want you, nor can He take you. But when you're bankrupt, willing to come, nothing in my hand I bring, simply to thy cross I cling, and there receive what He has to offer. God can and will save you, and not until then. Shall we pray? With our heads this morning bowed in prayer, for I had no intention this morning of giving an invitation. I think this morning we'll give the invitation to let anyone here that's come in here today. Trusting self, or oh, and there's so many today, trusting church membership. And a lot of folk in the Church of the Open Door think that just because they are members here, that that somehow or another carries merit before God. It doesn't. If you this morning are willing to come on God's terms, and you'll have to come His way. The Lord Jesus said, I'm the way. And He said, no man comes to the Father but by me. If you're willing to come that way, He'll save you. If you're not, He says you're lost. I don't. He says it.